Bitcoin has failed on every promise that promoters made. It's not a store of value. It's not a safe haven. It's not an inflation hedge. It's not digital gold. It's not a non-correlated asset. It's nothing. And in fact, if you think about it from the perspective of Russians or anybody else, if you're looking for a safe place to put your assets because you're afraid that some foreign government is going to seize it, gold is where you want to go. I mean, these Russian oligarchs that are afraid of having their assets confiscated, they're not going to take a chance on something as risky as Bitcoin. You can't put real money into Bitcoin, but you can put a lot of real money into gold and keep it safe. In fact, this is how I think this is going to backfire on the dollar. The dollar's going up right now. Enjoy that rally while it lasts, because everything that's happening is going to put the dollar's reserve currency status into jeopardy. Think about it from China's perspective. You're watching what's going on. The U.S. doesn't approve of what Russia is doing in the Ukraine, and I don't approve of it either, but that's neither here nor there. But the U.S. doesn't approve of it, and look at how Russia is being punished. The reason Russia is vulnerable is because they have reserves and other assets that foreign governments can seize. I mean, we're shutting them out of the U.S. SWIFT system. We're seizing their dollar reserves. I mean, Russia is holding onto these foreign currency reserves in case there's an emergency. Well, here there's an emergency. The ruble is crashing, and they have no access to those reserves. In fact, the only central bank that's still working with Russia is China. And I wonder if we're going to retaliate against China. Now, potentially, the Biden administration is not dumb enough to do that. But even if we don't directly retaliate now, the idea that we might do something similar clearly is not going to sit well with the Chinese, who have trillions of U.S. dollars invested in U.S. treasuries or other assets that we may just decide to seize or default on if we don't agree with something that the Chinese are doing. And it doesn't necessarily have to be invading another country. I mean, we could flex this muscle whenever we want, and I don't think China enjoys basically putting a noose around its neck and throwing the other end to the United States. So I think you're going to see the Chinese really stepping up their selling of U.S. dollars and U.S. treasuries at a time where the Federal Reserve is saying that it's going to be reducing its balance sheet. It's not going to be rolling over maturing treasuries. And so it's going to be very difficult for the U.S. government to unload these treasuries in that environment, because we're still running these record deficits. And I also think we have the potential, if we're going to bring Russia and China even closer together, India might end up being pulled into that. That's about 40% of the world population that we may be alienating and pushing out of the U.S. dollar system to our own detriment, because we depend on the dollar's reserve currency status. That's the reason that the U.S. market is holding up a lot better than it is. But if that rug gets pulled out from under it, look out below. Look at other markets on the week. Oil prices up 26%. We close at $115 a barrel for the price of oil. Copper, by the way, hit a record high. Wheat is surging. So massive increases in food and energy prices. Now, I know a lot of people are talking about how this is inflationary. This is not inflationary. Oil prices going up, food prices going up, that's not inflationary. Because what happens is that if consumers have to spend more money to eat or heat their homes or drive their cars, they have less money available to buy other stuff. And so the prices of the things that you're not buying go down. And so there is no net overall increase in prices. What makes the prices go up is when the central bank responds to rising energy prices or rising food prices by printing more money, which is what they're going to do. Because as consumers have to tighten their belts because food is so expensive, because home heating oil or gasoline are so expensive, and they cut back spending on everything else, that causes a recession. And that results in the Fed printing more money. And that's what's inflationary. How the government responds to rising food and energy prices causes inflation, not the increase in prices themselves. And by the way, the same thing may happen in the Eurozone. You know, I was pointing out the absurdity of the ECB claiming that they needed more inflation because they weren't close enough to 2%. They needed an inflation that was close to but below 2%. And they were almost there, but not quite. They weren't at 1.9. And so they were saying, we need more inflation. We have to solve this problem. It was a non-existent problem. It didn't need a solution. But now they have a real problem and there is no solution because now inflation is way above 2% and it's going to keep on rising. What are they going to do about that problem? Because so far, nobody at the ECB is talking about fighting inflation. No one is talking about raising interest rates or shrinking the balance sheet, but it's going to have to happen because as bad as it is in the U.S. right now, it's actually worse over there. Prices are rising more because of the weak euro. They're dealing with record high oil prices. We're not at a record high yet in America. Now, we may be next week. The record high is about $148 a barrel. We could get there next week. But obviously, if the euro keeps falling against the dollar, it's going to be even more pain over in Europe. The dollar index was up about 2% on the week, obviously the biggest mover being the euro. But as the dollar was going up, treasury yields were going down. That was also part of the flight into the U.S. It was a flight into U.S. treasuries. 10-year yields dropped from 1.99 to 1.724. Yield on the 30-year went from 2.3 to 2.15.
Before we continue, help us clicking that YouTube like button and subscribe now to our channel. This shows the algorithm that you valued this information. And it helps us spread that message. Sharing is caring. And now, let's continue.
Lost in all the noise, though, was the jobs report that was released today, and it came out better than expected. The consensus was for a gain of 390,000 non-farm payrolls for the month, and that would have followed 467,000 new jobs in January. There was a slight upward revision of the January number up to 481,000, but the February number came out well above expectations. In fact, even above the high end of expectations, 678,000 jobs created in February. But now that you have global markets in turmoil, you have all this going on in the Ukraine, that just makes the rate hikes even worse. So the problems that the U.S. market had before Russia invaded the Ukraine, those problems exist now, only now we have another problem on top of that. So we have a long way to go down in the U.S. stock market. If I was long a bunch of U.S. stocks, I would be very nervous about what's likely to happen on Monday. Now, one part of this jobs report, though, that some people took comfort in, and I think that that's false comfort, was the average hourly earnings number, which surprised everybody in that it was flat. The expectation was for a gain of 0.5%, and instead, it was zero. I mean, the low end of the expectation was for a 0.4% increase. The prior month's 0.7% rise was actually revised down to just up 0.6. And so that means the year-over-year gain in wages, which was expected to be 5.8%, is only 5.1%, which is well below the 5.7% year-over-year gain that we had in January. Now, a lot of people looked at this number and said, oh, this is some relief on the inflation front. This shows that inflation is subsiding because wages are not up as much as we thought, and so that's good news for consumers. I think it's bad news for consumers. I think it means that if you have a job, your wages may be going up, but they're not going up nearly as fast as your cost of living because the pressure on consumer prices is going to persist. In fact, it's getting higher. All that's happening is the gap between wages and other prices is widening. That means real wages are going to be falling even faster. So that makes inflation even more painful for people who are working. And of course, if you're not working, if you're just living on some kind of fixed income, you don't get any increase in that compared to the increase in the cost of living. So I don't see any relief in these numbers. I don't think they indicate that the inflation pressures are off because remember, inflation is not caused by rising wages. There's no such thing as the wage price spiral. Wages are prices and prices go up because of money supply going up because the Fed is creating inflation and they're going to create a lot more inflation. I don't care what the Fed is posturing right now, based on what's going on in the global economy and what's going to be going on in the U.S. economy, we're going to have a lot more inflation, but that's not going to stop the recession from coming. It's going to be stagflation, but the stagnation will be so bad and the inflation will be so bad that a better way to describe it will be an inflationary depression.
Do you want to know one thing about crypto? I made over 3,000% in profit in a few weeks. Fact is, the traditional financial system, the traditional money system makes you poor, not rich. If you want to earn $500,000, $1 million, You have to wait until you're 50, 60, 70 in the traditional financial system, and you probably will still be broke. And you will be old. This is not a sexy combination, as you can imagine. But the question is, how can you start in crypto and make these profits? Where to invest? Where do you start? My name is Gunnar and I'm from Germany, as you can hear, and things are a little bit different in Germany. More about that later on. Fact is, there are lots of different cryptocurrencies. It's a gigantic universe where beginners and professionals get easily lost. But there is light at the end of the tunnel. There are 7 key steps you need to follow to become successful in this market. You have to know them, and if you fail one of them, it's literally impossible to succeed in this market. Just an example, one of the key points is your exchange, and one of the biggest are, for example, Binance and Coinbase. These are trusted and well-established exchanges, but, and this is a big but, you won't find the super profitable coins on those exchanges. The unknown super profitable coins that get gigantic profits are not traded on those kind of exchanges. They are traded on much smaller insider platforms that are barely known. And I can tell you what those super secret exchanges are and why they are so profitable. And another super important thing are the right information sources. The point is, the internet is gigantic. There are hundreds and hundreds of YouTube channels, blogs, pages, and much, much more. And there are also market makers and influencers. For example, Elon Musk, he is not a crypto guy, but the moment he recommended Dogecoin, it went through the roof, to the moon, so to say. But why did he recommend it? Where did he hear it from? He didn't hear it from newspapers. And believe me, he is listening to someone. But you have to know who, and you have to react before he is reacting. This is really, really important. And these are only 2 of the 7 steps you have to follow in order to be successful in crypto. And if you want to know all of these steps in much more detail, and if you want to have a comprehensive checklist, here's what you should do. There is a link below this video. Click on this link and you will get the opportunity to subscribe to my channel. Click on the link and you will see a video where I explain the next steps. So, see you soon. Click on the link now. I'll see you there.